We are going to begin our final session now with a panel discussion on pathways to net zero, and I'm going to start by introducing your moderator, Dan Wicklum, who has 25 years of experience managing research, driving innovation, and fostering collaboration in and among industry, government, academia, and civil society. He was CEO of Canada's Oil Sands Innovation Alliance, was executive director of the Canadian Forest Innovation Council, and has been a senior manager at Environment and Climate Change Canada and Natural Resources Canada. And Dan managed to do all of that after a successful career as a professional football player. He won both the Vanier Cup in university and the Grey Cup with the Winnipeg Blue Bombers in 1988. I remember watching that game. So Dan, over to you.
Great, thank you very much, folks. Good to see some pretty good attendance here late in the conference. So we have about an hour together. The run of show here is we'll do some introductions. I'm going to make about a 10-minute presentation about net zero and how net zero changes everything. The Canadian Nuclear Association has asked me to do that. And then we are going to have a group discussion with the panel. We'll ask some staged questions, I would say, and then we're going to go to the audience for some questions as well. So first of all, introductions. So first of all, from your perspective, to my immediate left, we have Heather Ferguson. Heather is truly one of these people that probably does not need an introduction, but reading her bio, I would call her senior VP of everything in OPG. But when you dig into that a little bit here, she's got two functions. She's on the OPG Enterprise Leadership Team, and she's the Senior Vice President of Business Development Strategy and Corporate Affairs. So she focuses her attention on developing and implementing OPG Strategic Growth Plan, generation development, acquisitions, electrification, on and on. She's also responsible for all stakeholder, public, and media outreach. Okay, in the middle here, we have Julianne Dekker. Again, another senior VP of everything. Project Delivery Nuclear Canada and CANDU Energy. And in this capacity, she's responsible for SNC-Lavalin's role in the refurbishment of Bruce and the OPG, as well as all new reactor design and delivery, including new builds and SMR development and support. Okay, fair enough. Now, on the far end, we've got a little bit of an issue here. So Jason Dion from the Canadian Climate Institute begged out on us about 7 minutes ago. So we madly phoned up Justin Hanna from NRCan and said, would you be a pitch hitter here? And he said, absolutely. So people probably, again, know Justin, but he's the director of nuclear energy at NRCan. And he's got a very strong background in industry. We absolutely have no idea what he's going to say, and he has no idea what he's going to be asked because he is such a late pinch hitter, but here he is. So welcome to all of you. Great. Okay, so I'm going to start off with the presentation. I have 10 minutes. I've got about five slides. I suggest that this is probably going to be a little bit thought-provoking and maybe a little bit challenging, but why not? Why have a panel unless you're going to do that? So I actually have two hats here. First of all, I lead this organization called the Transition Accelerator. It's a new NGO with a new methodology for driving system change. That's one hat. The second hat is I'm co-chair of something called the Net Zero Advisory Body, or NZAB, which is a new body underneath the new Canadian Emissions Reduction Accountability Act, the federal act that requires the government to put in place interim targets to net zero. And this NZAB that I co-chair has two functions: advise on interim targets on the way to 2050, and the second is to advise the Minister of ECCC and the Prime Minister on the most likely pathways to net zero. So there's actually great synergy between my two roles. So I'm speaking, frankly, on behalf of both of those functions here. So I'm gonna set a bit of a frame here, the concept of net zero and how we think at the NZAB and the Accelerator, we think it changes everything in ways that maybe we haven't fully thought through. So I'm gonna speak in terms of a paradigm, original paradigm of emissions reduction. We've been in that for 30 years. Think Kyoto and the Copenhagen agreements. But now we've into this emission elimination paradigm inside of a net zero definition. So think the momentum that was started in the Paris. So emissions reduction paradigm for the last 30 years. But now we're in an emissions elimination paradigm. And I'm gonna go through about 8 differences that we see. I'm gonna say, I'm actually truncating a full day course that we give on this into about 10 minutes, so I'm gonna speak quite quickly. So this first slide is actually, I think, quite easy to understand, very intuitive. So in an emissions reduction paradigm, the questions that dominated that phase are things like, is climate change real? In an emissions elimination paradigm, we're no longer asking that question. The answer is yes. In an emissions reduction paradigm, the question was, are emissions causing climate change, or is climate change anthropogenic? The answer is yes, beyond doubt. How important will effects be with questions in reduction? The answer is very important. Every piece of analysis that I or we are aware of shows that the cost of inaction, even financially, in addressing climate change is more than the cost of action, despite the sticker shock that we have in the great cost of action. So how important will effects be? Is acting worth it? Yes, it is worth it. That's no longer a debate. And in an emissions reduction paradigm, we had this concept of sectoral or company or government aspirations. People thought it was very telling to say that we align with a net zero 2050 state. I think we're actually past that now. I mean, that's table stakes now to say that you understand. That's really saying we understand. In an emissions elimination paradigm, progressive government sectors, companies will have a plan that is credible, capable, and frankly, very quickly, I believe they'll be required to have some independent third-party verification. Fair enough. Okay. Here's a couple of three points that sort of thread together into something that I think is really worth thinking about. In the emissions reduction paradigm, there were many, many options to reduce emissions. We almost had limitless options. If all you have to do is reduce emissions in your whole society, you have the ability, for example, to say, we're going to leave sectors A, B, C alone. We're not going to require them to reduce their emissions because we can get sufficient reductions from sectors D, E, and F. So when you start to put together the permutations and combinations, it was frankly limitless options to reduce emissions. Contrast that with an elimination paradigm, we actually have to get basically every sector to as close as we can to zero. That means we've lost the optionality of trade-offs among sectors. The implication of this reduction paradigm of reducing emissions is that we actually didn't ever have to change our systems, how we move things around the landscape and transportation, how we heat ourselves and buildings, agriculture, a whole energy system. All those systems could remain substantially the same. We just had to make them more efficient because we just had to reduce emissions, and emissions are reduced with efficiency. But now that we actually need to get all of our systems as close as we can to zero under a net zero definition, we actually have to fundamentally retool all our systems. And we're seeing this play out, for example, first in the transportation system. For the whole emissions reduction paradigm, the major tool we had was the clean fuel standard. The internal combustion engine could remain the major way that we move things around our landscape, and we just had to make it more efficient with the clean fuel standard. Now, the whole world, especially in North America and in Canada, is coming out with zero emission vehicle mandates. They're basically saying we cannot incrementally change our existing system and get to net zero. We have to fundamentally retool it. It means no more internal combustion engines. So that's really what's happened in the transportation system as we move from emissions reduction paradigm to emissions elimination paradigm. The question is, how is that going to play out across every sector in our economy? And do we really understand this? And what does it mean for us? And what does it mean for leaders and managers? If you keep playing with that, what has happened in the transportation system is people have said we are not able to get to a fundamentally retooled net zero transportation system in the future by making incremental changes to our existing system. We have to define what the future system needs to look like and build a pathway to it. So in this number 8 point, this notion of incremental change being insufficient and incapable of all of a sudden delivering net zero systems in the future that are functional is, I think, a remarkable implication of this notion of reduction to elimination paradigm. So number 8, incremental changes from our existing systems are unlikely to yield the net zero systems we need in 28 years for Canada to contribute to the emissions reductions imperative around the world and also emerge as a strong economy. So I've got one very quick example here about how this plays out. So net zero changes everything. That's the paradigm. Many ways to reduce emissions, very few energy systems. In this case, I'll talk about an energy system, can be functional and net zero. These data on the screen, on this pie, are actual real data. They're from NRCan. Details don't matter, but as you can see, our current energy system is dominated by fossil fuels. And then you've got a yellow pie wedge there, it's electricity and some green biomass. So if you buy this notion that changing our existing systems incrementally will not yield future functional net zero systems, the question is, what would a future functional net zero energy system look like? And how would we build a pathway to that system? So we've taken a crack at it. This is a potential net zero energy system in 2050. It's wrong, we all know that. But actually, when you take a look around the world, there's remarkable consensus emerging about what the big pieces of a net zero energy system would be. There's gonna be massive electrification. I don't think anyone is debating that. But we also know that you can't electrify everything. We'll probably need hydrogen as an energy carrier. So there will probably be massive hydrification as well. There will be more biomass for sure. There will certainly still be some fossil fuels with carbon capture and storage. So the details in debating what this energy system looks like is not really the point of why I'm bringing it up. The point is, do we need to define what the future energy system looks like? To the extent we can, leaving open optionality, and then build a pathway to it. And I've got one more slide. And this is, John had asked me to sort of frame the magnitude of the challenge. You know, we always talk about, at least now, the notion that we're gonna have to double or triple or quadruple the grid. But wow, are those different propositions for the country and the economy and our captains of industry to have to pull off, remarkably different. But it is time to start boxing that in. So this is a conceptual model, not anchored into any real life, but what would be the next slide, I've taken a real world overlay into what would it take to actually deliver that future energy system. So I'm gonna set the next slide up. The yellow on the right-hand pie is 130% increase in the grid from our existing system. So in the right-hand pie, we've assumed we've increased our grid by 1.3 times. So the question is, where does all this energy come from to create all that hydrogen we need to have the same amount of petajoules that we're gonna need in 2050? We just assume it's the same as today. Population will increase, we'll get more efficient. So just for argument's sake, we said we need the same number of petajoules. So the next slide is the additional energy we need to make that amount of hydrogen after we've increased the grid by 130%. And this is what it looks like. So it ends up to be about 64 kilotons of hydrogen a day. So after we've increased the grid by 130%, on top of that, we'll need something around 66,000 wind turbines, 195 site Cs. Like it is unfathomably staggering the challenge that we have in front of us. But it's time now, as John talks, to move from the theology, the emotion, the abstract debates around this to the math. How are we actually gonna get it done? So that's one option, that electricity, or in this option, we could also get that amount of energy to make the required amount of hydrogen from upgrading natural gas and carbon capture and storage. And it would take about 72% of Canada's natural gas production. So look, the purpose is not to debate these numbers. The purpose is conceptually, do we need to define what the future system needs to look like, at least to the extent we can with underneath all the real world constraints and build a pathway to it. So that's my initial frame. So we are now back to the panel. If we could turn that slide off so people don't get distracted, that would be great.
I like it there, actually. It's a good reference.
Look, Heather wants it there. Let's keep it up. I'm not gonna fight that. So look, why don't we start with the middle, Julianne.
Okay.
So looking for some opening remarks, but also looking to you to answer the question, what are the main drivers to consider as we go on this remarkable journey to net zero? Economic drivers, other drivers, and how has the emissions elimination paradigm changed how we think about drivers?
Yeah, so I guess I'll, you brought up John and his discussion yesterday with Jerry Butts, and as good engineers, we did bring our math books to the table to try to sort out, we call it engineering net zero, and it's really all about that math problem. And do we have the time to solve it? And we've actually, if you could just play, we've got a really short video, and then I'll speak to, kind of what we found through that.
Thank you. I sort of feel like standing up and singing O Canada right now.
Yeah. But
it's good stuff.
Yeah. So, but you know, so you talked about what are the practical aspects of this, and you know, and again, this came up yesterday, but it's important to repeat that a lot of countries around the world are going at their climate change problem and trying to decarbonize by attacking the electricity sector first. And here in Canada, of course, we have a very low carbon electricity sector. So we have to start with what I would say is more the hard stuff first if we're gonna decarbonize. And that's really making those system level changes to try to get, you know, whether it's electrifying transportation or building heating and all these things. And that actually requires, you know, the build out of the electricity grid to enable that. So, and when we look at, okay, how are we going to approach that? Whether you're talking transmission projects, or are you talking about, you know, large scale generation projects? You know, these things take, you know, 10 years to come together. So certainly time is not on our side in terms of being able to accomplish that. Another point, and I know Mike Renchek has alluded to this a number of times, that our financial systems are also not designed around large-scale assets that will have, you know, an economic life of 75, 100 years, because, you know, we look for amortizations over 20, 30 years. And so there's certainly more system-level change that has to happen in order to enable those kinds of big, you know, baseload projects, whether it's hydro or it's you know, large nuclear. But there's also, as we go through the system change, you know, there's some resistance, because there's a sense of loss. I mean, that first picture that you put up, 75% of our economy is driven by hydrocarbons, and that also fuels, you know, our export markets and everything else. And I think what we have to do is we have to give Canadians a sense of urgency in terms of providing an alternative economic driver. And that economic driver, it can't just be clean energy projects, which of course are important, and that's how, you know, that they're part of the stepping stones to get to net zero, but it has to include the development of technology, because domestic technology drives economic sectors. And you look at like CANDU technology, you know, it drives, you know, 200 companies and 76,000 jobs are built around a domestic technology. And so I think the urgency will come with, you know, Canadians figuring out, if we are the first to innovate clean technologies that we can deploy domestically or export, and that could be hydrogen, it can be nuclear, then it can drive a new economy as well as the urgency to do it first.
You know, when we set the accelerator up, we wanted to come up with a new methodology to help drive change. So we went to change experts and said, if you were going to design a transition, what are the elements that should be in there to capitalize on the human psychology of decision-making and so on? And one of the things they said was, it's really difficult to get people to change from a known situation, even if it's sort of crappy, to an unknown situation. So you're, I think, talking about this notion of vision, or giving people an understanding of what the future would look like, is really taking that unknown out, that scary unknown out of the transition equation. So the change from an existing situation to a known situation. Mm-hmm. So, Heather, opening remarks.
Okay. Opening
remarks.
And then
if you could touch on this notion of what's the role of hydrogen in the.
No, I do that. I do the role of the province now.
Okay.
But before I start, I want to say thank you, everybody, for showing up in fairly decent numbers for the third day of what's been an amazing, but I think everyone would agree, an exhausting conference. Two late nights, a lot of FaceTime with people. It's been wonderful, but exhausting. So thank you for that. And I know Dan already mentioned a thank you to Justin, but I just wanted to say, let's give Justin a big hand here, because big hand. I literally phoned him at 10:18. So thank you for that. And hopefully you'll add some fluidity and free form to this conversation, which I think is great. So before I talk about what I'm supposed to talk about, I also want to build off what Julianne said, and this notion of being practical. And I think you touched on it when you said, okay, in Ontario or Canada, we have a clean electricity system. The electricity system is always the place where people start for some reasons, you know, the federal government's come out with its clean electricity standard, driving it to net zero by 2035, when the practical viewpoint really needs to be, okay, how clean of a system can you have? Look at Ontario, 95% GHG free. And it's actually some very quick things that you can do to further drive down emissions in a very practical way. Transportation, there's some harder ones, buildings and others, but transportation is the lowest hanging fruit possible. But if you drive that system in 2035 down to zero, net zero, you will not have the reliability there to electrify everything you want to. And so we can all say that, and you know, I say that, many others have said that. I think we need to sit down and have real conversations with the government and show them what that really means. I mean, you put a pretty mind-boggling picture there. OPG has got some mind-boggling numbers. It sounds like SNC does as well. And we need to sit down and offer our advice and our insights in a very tangible and productive way. So I think that's, you know, from a practical perspective. The province. You want me to do the province or you want me to do hydrogen?
I don't think I have much of a role here, so I think
okay.
You should do whatever heck you want.
Yeah. Well, no, let's do hydrogen, okay? I'll do what I was told. So hydrogen, I mean, everybody's talking about hydrogen. A lot of panelists have been speaking about hydrogen. That was a pretty great figure, which is why I actually wouldn't mind if it was still up there. But so hydrogen.
We brought the figure up. I'm going to hear this later if we don't get
well,
that figure.
Well, what can't hydrogen do? I mean, it's a terrific opportunity to reduce GHGs in transportation, industrial processes, all the things you showed there. It's an opportunity to mitigate greenhouse gases from the gas side of things, and we're looking at doing that in Ontario. So it's a wonderful opportunity. There's nothing it can't do, but the two most important parts of that whole piece are the electricity. So what form of electricity are you using to generate the hydrogen and the cost of that electricity? So you want the cleanest electricity so that you've got the cleanest hydrogen or nearly the cleanest hydrogen, and you want the cost to be reasonable. And so, I mean, when I think about this audience here, nuclear plays a tremendous role in that because it's affordable, clean, baseload electricity for the system. But we need to think about that everywhere. And over time, what we're going to need to do is basically build up a bit of an economy. So we need an economy of scale with hydrogen. We don't have that yet. OPG is looking to deploy an electrolyzer at our Niagara facility. The province just announced a whole strategy around hydrogen. I think it's going to grow, but it's a chicken and egg thing, and you need to build out an economy of scale around that if it's going to really take a meaningful place in the net zero, which I think it will.
So what I took from your comments really was this notion of needing a real-world overlay. Like, it's great to have aspirations, but it's time to move from theology to math.
So.
For sure.
And
it is a
math equation.
And the other thing here is this notion of, you know, we are absolutely fixated on 2035 for obvious reasons, because that's sort of the policy direction, when in fact, our ultimate objective really needs to be, what's the functional net zero electricity system in this country in 2050? And the pathways, you know, forcing the pathway to 2035, we need to make sure that's compatible with getting it to 2050. I think wearing my NZAB hat, that's the real challenge, right? So, Justin, in the 12 minutes you had to prepare for this panel, can you
12.
Speak to, of course, seven. You know, look, you work for the government of Canada, so that's the perspective you're the most able to speak from. So I guess the way I look at it in this country, you know, we all know we have a remarkably complex democracy. You know, our constitution is quite complex. Many people on the outside look at us as saying that is the way a country should work. That's a super functional country. From the inside, sometimes there are these tensions. Look, the electricity system is provincial jurisdiction. We know that. And yet the federal government has a responsibility and a great vision to help drive the country to net zero 2050. So in this sort of tension of constitutional responsibility, can you speak to federal government's role, plan, and maybe how that role is evolving?
Yeah, sure. I mean, first and foremost, I think people are looking for leadership from the federal governments in a way where we acknowledge that we need to move to net zero by 2035. We've acknowledged that, we've made commitments towards it, and I think what significant step I believe we've gone through now is made the case for nuclear. The release of the emissions reductions plan and the federal budget in the past 2 weeks have, in my mind, been some of the strongest signals we've seen in the past 10 years on this federal government's commitments to nuclear. But as you said, it's complicated. We have a shared jurisdiction with the provinces, and our role as the federal government is to create the right policies and enabling conditions for not only nuclear, but all zero emission technologies to build this new economy and support this paradigm shift that we're gonna need to move to. And it's no small feat. It's gonna take a coordinated effort from the federal government, from the provincial governments, from industry stakeholders, and we wanna continue to engage and work with industry stakeholders, but also our indigenous partners. I think that's another thing where we can really share and demonstrate leadership. I've over the past couple of years, I've seen a real attunement and focus on bringing all of those players and actors together under one umbrella. And I acknowledge and recognize that people are going to continue to look to the federal government in providing that leadership, in providing the policies and the regulatory environments, and also the funding that's going to be required to make this shift happen. And it's got to start now. So we're happy to play our role. I think we're on the precipice, as John Gorman has said, on something great. And I'm just glad to be here at this very exciting time to work with everyone to figure out the roadmap from now to 2035.
Okay, great. Folks, we are going to go to questions from the floor so we can get those ready. And I think I sort of balled up the opening remarks and the questions after the fact. But Julianne, do you need any more comments or insight on that notion of drivers?
Well, I think so. And Justin just touched on this, but the Indigenous partnership, I think, is something that is so vital to this transition. And I think, I sort of brought this up about, creating domestic technologies and driving new economic ecosystems around clean energy, and of course nuclear being a huge part of that. Yeah. And I think there is a lot of areas where we can align and bring long-term equity to Indigenous communities through new clean energy sectors such as nuclear, and have long-term partnerships. And I do think that's where there is more, and this is what we've heard over and over and over from Indigenous leaders, is I don't want to just hey, great, we get some jobs when there's a project and then the project is over and things go away. And this is what I'm talking about, of how do we have this transition benefit everybody in Canada, including the Indigenous First Nations, and have them have long-term prosperity through this transition.
Right. Get ready for questions from the floor. I'm going to go off script a little bit here and think about how people are now perceiving nuclear electricity in a fundamentally different light, frankly, over the last 18 months, maybe 2 years, maybe a year. But I think the people that are now supporting nuclear that maybe not in the past are quite sophisticated. I mean, they understand the role of nuclear in this really remarkable challenge, and they have a sophistication about how difficult it will be without nuclear. But we probably have work to do for those that want to advance nuclear with the broader society. I mean, nuclear is still sort of a lightning rod that evokes great emotion among people. Can you comment on that dynamic and how to potentially change that dynamic, I would say, to clear the path to additional nuclear capacity in the country? This is the pregnant pause. This is the pregnant pause. That's right.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
You go ahead.
All right. Well, this is interesting you say. So Ken was up here, 2 days ago or whatever, and we were talking about what are some messages that are really important around this theme, around nuclear. Everyone in this room loves nuclear, or I assume you do. Or if you spent 3 days at a place where you'd rather not be. But we all know nuclear is great. The problem is we talk in nuclear talk. We don't talk in the kind of talk that is going to educate and share our views with people that need to. So we need to spend a lot less time, probably with each other. I mean, we'll come together once a year at this, but let's make a really concerted effort to attend events, to hold venues, to have conversations with the broader public, the people who are going to be influencing the decisions that need to be made by the federal government around this. So that would be one big ask. And the other one is, and I think you started talking about it, we need to spend way more time with Indigenous communities, sharing what we know about this industry, helping them to understand it better. But as I think Chief Weitung said the other day, it's a two-way conversation, and we can learn almost more from them than the other way around. And so if I think we did that, we actually made a concerted effort. Like, you go home and you think, okay, I love being at the CNA. I'm going to go to 3 events this year, and I'm going to show up, and I'm going to present to a different type of an audience, and I'm going to make a really concerted effort to outreach to some Indigenous communities and take an opportunity to meet with them. I can't imagine how much further ahead we'll be in 1 year.
Any other thoughts from you two? That is a confirmation that everyone in the room likes nuclear energy, by the way. So that's, you know, your assumption was right. Any other thoughts?
Well, I think it has to be, you know, it has to be a pull from the market, right? And you know, for a long time, we've been in this mode of, you know, trying to explain and trying to bring the logic to the table of, this is why it's so great, let us show you. But there has to be a pull from the marketplace to say, we want this, and you know, we want to have new nuclear, new builds. We want to develop technology that we can export. And this is why I think there's just so much about the fact that, you know, as I sort of mentioned this before, but there is a sense of fear of loss by moving away from hydrocarbons in Canada, because we've been such a powerhouse and an energy exporter. And by, you know, we have to show people that there is an alternative. So, the logic sort of lines up that I think you're gonna see a real pull from people saying, no, we wanna be first to develop new technologies that we can drive economic sectors, where we can export, where we can help other countries decarbonize, and also a pull for having those projects exist in their local area.
I would say the big elephant in the room on that notion of sense of loss, we can have all the economic models we want saying, you know, Canadian GDP may or may not change, you know, export dollar value of exports may not change, but the reality is the spatial scale matters. And if you work at a mom and pop gas company in rural Saskatchewan, you may or may not have to see a direct line of sight between the current situation, what works for you, and a future one that's more difficult. And that's, of course, one of our great challenges.
But I think the other part of the pull is going to come, I mean, and this is, we've heard this throughout this conference, but we're hearing it more and more in the media and everywhere else, is energy security. And it is so vitally important. And again, this is where, I mean, the facts are here that, you know, this is a sector right now in the nuclear sector, Canada is energy independent. And we have helped other countries be energy independent, and they don't have to import fuel from Russia or, you know, so, you know, these are some other really important considerations. And I do think the more that people understand about it, there will be a pull from the market saying we should be doing more of this.
Yeah, just to build on that, I mean, we've talked about, I've been at this conference for 10 plus years, and we've always talked about communication. And we all know, I feel like we were the original industry that had these very polar opposite views about who we are and what we contributed. And now we're seeing that proliferate in all other aspects of political discourse. But what always sticks with me is I remember seeing some polling data a few years ago about this silent center, right? Where you've got, are you pro or opposed to nuclear? And you've got 10 to 20% of people who are absolutely opposed, 10 to 20% of the people who are absolutely supportive, mainly people in here. And then you've got this very silent center who just don't really have an opinion on it because it's a bit of a black box. And the only references they see to it is either through disasters or The Simpsons. And so, but what the polling data showed that is if you just educated people on 2 to 3 very important facts on nuclear, on the value of our contribution to the medical field, or the economic opportunities, or the job opportunities in the STEM categories, you could move a large portion of that very soft center into the pro category. And I think that's, you know, that's one of the things we need to focus on. Not have to explain everything that, you know, the culmination of the knowledge in this room has, but really just say there's a climate crisis, there's energy security, and we're gonna need to make a paradigm shift, and this is a technology and an industry that's gonna address all of the pieces of that solution.
I can't help but think that there's some lessons to be learned from the oil sands sector. I was in that sector for about 7 years, and I think that sector found a very hard time facting their way, or you know, educating their way out of sort of their comm situation. You know, I think they're realizing now that people often make decisions based on emotion. I mean, we are a very non-representative group in the society right here. Like everyone here has got at least one degree, right? So, that notion of sort of really crisping up the decision, and this is oversimplified, but the decision sort of is, we miss net zero, or we use nuclear. Mm-hmm. Like, take your pick. That's oversimplification, but we're getting to that point where those are stark trade-offs that could be framed and playing on people's, emotional decision-making as well as the facts.
Yeah, the debate, the challenge we've always had is, to your point, is trying to address an emotional issue with facts.
Yeah.
Right? And it's just, history has shown that's a real challenge, right? Yeah. And so we need to somehow create some semblance of an emotional overlay on this, yeah, that it's an existential issue. And we also, our leadership, whether it's at the provinces, municipal, or federal level, need to be forthcoming and honest. I mean, that's not easy for politicians to do. Being forthcoming and honest about the choices in front of us and the decisions that need to be made.
But it's about the conversation, I think, too. I mean, you're right. The facts aren't going to compel people around an emotional issue. But if you begin the conversation and offer people an opportunity to come and learn more about nuclear, come visit a nuclear project, come out to Darlington, come out to Bruce, come visit a waste facility. That's usually the mind-blowing one. When they go to the waste facility and they actually come to appreciate what the waste facility looks like, it's that conversation. And it's very important how you approach it. It's not in sort of you're trying to sell them anything. It's just, would you like to come see this?
You pull the curtain away.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's go to the audience here. I would very much like some extremely confrontational questions so we could get some discord and disagreement among the panel up here. That would be very fun.
Thank you very much.
Got a couple.
I cut you. But that's what us French Canadians do. We cut the English Canadians. So, Guy Hott, Kinetrix, and the CNS first vice president. So, thanks for the talk, Barry. Just one thought first, theology and math. I like the buzzword. First time I heard it, but then I started thinking.
I got off of Gorman just saying. So.
But the thing, I started thinking about it in theology. Well, there's cathedrals, Notre Dame de Paris, literature, art, life after that. Math, well, that's what most high school students can't wait to get to college so that they can stop studying it. So I'm not sure that that's the right media for the message, but just a joke. So, because I like the light side of your presentation that helps at this time. One question is the incremental change, and I think I agree with that. Incremental will not make it, but there's another part of the equation. It's incremental funding. So right now, that's what we're seeing all over, and probably that's why we're not reaching reactors. It's not $50 million, $100 million in a budget that's going to make it. We're talking billions of dollars. Even if it's not nuclear, it's going to be billions of dollars to do this. So I'd like to hear what you have to say about how do we solve that problem of incremental funding, or do we have to do like for the pandemic and wait till the pandemic hits us before the money starts flowing?
Any thoughts, folks? Maybe I'll prime one thing. This, one of the benefits of creating a vision of the future or defining the future is then you can make a business plan around attaining an outcome that has already been boxed and defined with some boundaries, but just additional prompting. Thoughts?
You go.
I mean, when you map out the paradigm shift we have to make, every gigawatt has a dollar cost attached to it. So it's just one more step to look at and say, we are going to have to shift from these carbon intensive gigawatts to these, non-emitting gigawatts. And every gigawatt that we shift is going to cost us X amount of dollars. And when you actually wrap your head around that and understand the magnitude of the investment that you need to make, then you can start having the conversations with more zeros behind it. for lack of a better
term. I don't think they've had the chance to digest that. I mean, I think many of us in the room have had some fairly recent conversations and are going to be having more conversations with the federal government in particular around the magnitude. And I think they're just starting to process that. So, I mean, I'm optimistic that we will see more coming forward as they see it's the number of zeros that need to be behind this. And then I think with that, what we'll see is more private investment feeling comfortable when they see those signals. And I'm optimistic it will get there, but you touched on that, the bankability, the financeability, as did Mike.
Yeah, and I would just say I'm not sure that we quite have the solutions yet, because there are real challenges, and I would not, you know, purport to be up here saying I know what the solutions are, but the challenges around trying to drive that investment in projects, again, with these long lifespans, and where it is, we've been in a mode where you're pricing things against hydrocarbons, and you know what's the price of gas today, and all the, and then is this competitive against that? And we need to be in a mode of, you know, how do we drive these massive projects? And it is massive. I mean, we need, you know, when we've done the math, it's, you know, it's two or three times the electricity grid. It's three times our historical build rate of infrastructure, energy infrastructure projects to get to something like that. So it doesn't mean it's not doable, but we're not seeing the economic drivers. But that's why I do believe that there is something to align like a Canadian industrial strategy in terms of what is the new economy going to look like, and how do we drive the right development of technologies and whatnot that will drive a new economy that's both domestic and an export market for us.
I just want to touch on the role of, Heather mentioned it, the role of private sector money. This we have to acknowledge and accept that this is the public purse will play an enabling role and initiating role, absolutely, but private sector finance is really going to have to come in and play their role. And it's going to be a big role. There are trillions of dollars circulating throughout the world looking for an investment home, and these are the investments that need to be made. So, you know, whether we're, you know, bringing Canadian pension plans or sovereign wealth funds from outside of Canada into the country, we have to create the enabling conditions for those investments to be sound. But I really think we're going to need to see a step change type of investment from the private sector in this industry for us to reach the build out, you know, forecast that we're looking at.
Another question from the floor.
Dan, Andrew Stewart here from Hydrogen Optimized. A great panel. Really think this is a really important part for the nuclear sector. I was going to ask a question, but I will. But you answered, Julianne, about having markets. And I really, that's what we have to have, is market pull for green products, and nuclear's role in it must connect to the end use. And nuclear is sort of in a bubble, and over here is called the Volvo driving car, selling cars made of green steel. Over here is someone who's making green steel. Over here is someone's making hydrogen. Over here is nuclear. And I think nuclear can't look so inward, but how does the nuclear industry get out to the end uses? Because of the word math. You've mentioned math. I agree with Heather, that slide should have been left on. I think you have to see scale, and I think this is where an ammonia plant, we see those being built all the time, lots in Western Canada. Well, it's 1,000 megawatts for one ammonia plant. And you have to see what the math means on these things. When you go from fossil energy to non-fossil, it's big. So how can nuclear get out of the bubble of so inward focus and get to markets, understanding systems and how nuclear energy, it's much more than, it's going to be building right. Nuclear for hydrogen production will be one thing, not for the grid. Right. Anyway, that's my question.
I'm just going to make one comment. We've got three more questions here, so I want to keep rolling. But like, I've got an awful lot of confidence. I've had some chance to interact with very senior leaders in the nuclear sector over the last 2 months, and they're, you know, top-notch people running top-notch companies. I've got great confidence that they're going to do great things. Question here.
Oh, hello. Yeah. Hi, Aaron Judah from Ontario Power Generation, and the panel's actually answered my question a little bit, but I'll preface it this way. So The panel has spoken an awful lot about innovation and the human aspects to it, which I think is actually the most important part, because if you don't have the technology, you can't move anything forward, and as well as the human structure of it. Now, where I get concerned and nervous is the execution. And the reason why I mention that is because in a past life, I actually worked for an oil company and did carbon capture number crunching for them. The technology is there. The technology can work. The reason why it got kiboshed was simply because the Bush administration at the time removed the tax credits and the incentives for it. And we're talking several changes of government later, nothing has moved. And my challenge to you is, how are we looking at this in terms of the execution to make sure it will be successful? Thank you.
As it relates to what, everything?
I mean, I'll notice on the carbon capture tax credit, you know, the Canadian federal government just came out in the most recent budget with some actually very, very aggressive incentives. But any thoughts on that?
I don't think we actually answered that gentleman's
question. So I thought
it was
more of a comment, sorry.
So,
okay. Does nuclear get out of its bubble, yeah, get in the markets where the end uses are?
Yeah.
Okay, this is a question
which,
of how.
I mean, I will say we've been slow to do that because I think traditionally, as operators, we operated our plants, our large nuclear plants. We started some massive refurbishments, you know, $12 billion each, huge, kind of was focused on that. But I think as we've seen SMRs come into play much, much, much more fully, and, you know, we want to build one in Ontario, but then we want the rest of Canada to build SMRs, and we need customers for that. So I think absolutely there's been strategic plans both at the federal and provincial level around that. Industry has come together. You know, all the companies that are interested in SMRs are talking and are going out and talking to the markets and where these are going to be built, whether it's a larger on-grid SMR or an off-grid SMR. It's happening. It's just probably not hugely evident right now because it's been a little bit slow and it's still early.
Well, and one other aspect of this is that we, you know, and, you know, I think, you know, Dan's organization in terms of the Net Zero Advisory Body and making sure that there is a plan that hangs together, we're starting to see it. But we still have, I mean, IESO in Ontario is a great example where IESO has not had the projection for the amount of electricity we're going to need to drive a net zero future. And they, you know, in all of their reports, there's little asterisks that say, you know, this doesn't really align with the climate strategy kind of thing. But OPG was actually instrumental in kind of, hey, this doesn't seem right. This doesn't. And so IESO has gone back and revised those projections. But it's really challenging for a utility to go out and plan for, again, like a 70 or 80 year facility, whether it's hydro or nuclear, when you've got, you know, projections for electricity generation that say we don't really need any more. So so there is work going on there. But to your point, I think there needs to be more of it. And we're realizing more and more that industry has a really big role to play to provide that education. But again, we do see, you know, the Net Zero Advisory Committee, the new Pan-Canadian Grid Council. There is more and more of, I think, areas where concrete plans can be made. And I, you know, I think that's where you know, the nuclear story will have to come in.
We've got three more questions. We'll try to get to them all. So maybe just one panelist answer each of the questions if we can. So, yes, sir.
Yeah, Hamel Bassi from Cambridge. So Dan, I'll try and be a little bit controversial, okay?
Excellent.
So the industry, our nuclear industry has been in a more of a competitive mode as opposed to a collaborative mode. If we're gonna meet that huge challenge that you put up on that screen, you know, to meet the net 2050 goals, we're going to have to, you know, think much bigger and collaborate. And the other thing is, there's a lot of Davids, you know, smaller companies that are innovative, responsive. And, you know, how are we going to work together as an industry and not criticize, you know, one SMR against the other? You know, what are we going to do to truly get to the public in a very positive, coordinated way?
So if you can just reframe it even a little bit, is this notion of are we still operating in a emissions reduction paradigm when it was basically a zero-sum game, cutthroat competition, when an emissions elimination paradigm and the magnitude of new capacity that we need to bring on would seem to see it's not a zero-sum game and there's more room for collaboration? Is that sort of a yay or nay or comment?
I'm going to be a little controversial and kind of disagree. And maybe that's just from my perspective. I work at OPG. I think the amount of collaboration that goes on in the nuclear industry is pretty amazing. And we spend a tremendous amount of time, for example, with Bruce Power, our partner in this province as a nuclear operator, and thinking about ways we can do things better and how can we support and help each other. And I mean, even down at the SMR level, I don't think there is a whole lot of duking it out and arguing and throwing one SMR under the bus versus another. I've seen no end of announcements and MOUs, and I think a greater appreciation and recognition that there's probably going to be place and space for many of them, whether you're talking about on-grid or you're talking off-grid or you're talking about one that can facilitate things that are going on in Alberta versus Saskatchewan. I think there's a place for all the nuclear technologies and a place for all the other clean technologies. I'm encouraged, but I appreciate your perspective. Thank you.
Just so you know, what he said was the answer was perfect. Do you want to sit here? I think you can maybe just switch.
No. Well, okay. How many more minutes do we have?
Another question. We've got five more minutes.
John, you don't get to ask a question.
Apparently he does. John Gorman from the CEO of the Canadian Nuclear Association.
Host prerogative, come on. I for the record, this is the very first question that I've asked during this conference, and I've been tempted. But can I just say quickly, Dan, thank you for your work with the Transition Accelerator and with NSAB. I know how hard you work, but I want to tell you that for me, having found the methodology that you've developed has given me a confidence and an optimism that, frankly, I needed as I look at the size of the challenge we face. So thank you for that. And just quickly, Justin, I think your addition to this panel actually has rounded it off very well. So my question for all or one of you is this. One of you flagged something very important, and I think it's this danger that with the federal targets, the short-term ones, especially the 2030 ones and maybe the 2035 ones, that we'll go all in and all focused on, very quickly deployable solutions. Maybe it's wind and solar, some lithium battery storage or something like that. And we will forget about this longer-term marathon that we're running, and I particularly wonder about things like water power development and, of course, nuclear power development cycles. So how do we ensure that we don't lose track of the longer picture here and get distracted too much by the short-term 2030, 2035 goals where water and nuclear can't deliver?
Well, I think, sorry, one of you guys talk, sorry.
You're rocking and rolling. Go ahead.
No, I take your point, John. I think there is concern at a federal level, I see it when there's too much focus on the renewable side of cleaning up the electricity grid. And that gets back to the point I said at the beginning, which I think if all the really smart people in this room actually take an opportunity to sit with the federal government and explain to them in very clear terms what that will mean if you go with wind and solar and batteries and you remove all gas from the system and you don't focus on your nuclear and your hydro because they can't meet your immediate need in the mid part of this decade, where will you end up from a cost perspective, a reliability perspective, and how negligible will your GHG improvements be? So that's at the federal level, but I see Minister Smith has just joined us here, and speaking about hydro, I think at the provincial level, there's a tremendous amount of focus on what water power potential remains in Ontario. I'm sure other provinces that have the benefit of water power are looking at it as well. And I would say work is underway, and we'll move as quickly as we can as a province to deliver that as well as nuclear solutions.
Well, and I was just, I was hoping Dan has this great slide, and it talks about dead-end pathways and not getting trapped into dead-end pathways where then you have to backtrack in order to get to the real 2050 goal. And I think it's really, really important to have near-term targets to hold ourselves accountable that we are going to hit our 2050 goals, but we have to be careful that those targets don't take us down a pathway where then we have to backtrack, because the problem is so enormous when we look at the build rate and how much infrastructure we have to put in place to transition to a clean economy that we simply can't afford rework along the way.
Thanks, Julianne. So look, we're back up against our time limit here. So Sarah, I know you've got a question. I'm just going to ask the panel to maybe convene at the back of the room so that this gentleman can ask his question. I'm going to go into a firing line here, 20 to 30 seconds each.
Okay.
In this remarkable challenge that we have, the imperative to get to net zero, what gives you optimism that we're going to be able to do it?
This budget that just came out, for me personally, this budget has been a real vote of confidence. I think starting the regional dialogues that Minister Wilkinson talked about, getting at the table with the provinces and rolling up our sleeves and saying, here are our targets, here are our priorities, what do we need to start working on today? Once we get those conversations going that I'm expecting to start this year, we've just got to identify nuclear as one of our priorities and just get on with it. And getting, you know, the Darlington project going, the GFP project going, you know, we're looking forward to our friends in Saskatchewan to move forward, our friends in New Brunswick to continue to move forward. There's a lot in my mind that's going to happen over the next 2 years. We're going to come back here next year and the year after that and be really, I'm hoping, you know, really just continuously enthused by the progress that we're making. And we're just getting started.
Yeah.
So for me, it may be cliche, but for me, what gives me optimism is the fact that, you know, we put a man on the moon in 1969. Because if you actually understood when the announcement was made by Kennedy, the science to make that happen in that time frame, there were materials that didn't exist that had to be invented. There were, you know, mathematical and computer systems that were not understood, that were invented along the way. And so when you look at the ingenuity and human innovation, when you have a lot of people, in that case, it was 400,000 people involved in that project to have a singular goal, and it got accomplished in the time frame that they set. So all we need is that collective willpower, and we can make it happen.
Heather. Okay, I'll be really quick because we're over. Maybe cliche as well, but it's the people in this room, actually, and our commitment to the nuclear industry. I think there's a lot of incredibly smart people, committed people here, so it will be the people in this room that will make this happen, and we know we can't get there without nuclear, so we need everyone in this room, and I'm very optimistic.
And for me, when I just sort of tie a stringer on all this, it's really pointing to the people to have the ability to innovate in new ways in a meaningful time frame. That's it. Folks, what a great panel. You are way better than Jason Dion ever would have been, I got to tell you. So I'm glad he's not here. So thanks for the panel. Yeah.